a wrinkled page, pockmarked, volcanic. Her cheek, a moonlit beach of white chocolate, leather and lace, tweed and silk. Their hands are woven together, together they walk apart. Their eyes are soft fountains, a breathless ballet of fingertips. She dreams of an ancient land, he of an alabaster vase. Love words not on her tongue. Her silver eyes display the future as an educated guess. Perhaps she seeks what he has already understood. Looking back, he sees the fruit growing fat and heavy. Sees the pomegranate plunge, the splat, the contiture of mud. Perhaps he seeks the fresh white page before the pen strikes blood. Who can know? Will the night sky remember the coming dawn? Can summer remember the snow? He wants to melt with unlimited potential. And right now, she wants to make love with eternity. A smile explodes between them. He feels so lucky. Oh, so lucky. He grows huge. He's proud of his young lover, wrapped in modernity's subterfuge. That swollen pump of resurgent pride enfolds the time bomb in his gut. Just how poignant his future disappointment will show him just how deep his egocentric rut. Will you recall your current ecstasy, a warrior for change, once fallen on the battlefield of doubt? For the enemy within defiles your purity without. See? Heads turn vicariously in the comet tail of your audacity. Untold stories surface through unwanted jolts of perspicacity. Let's look now and see behind the veil of lust and shame what lurks in the shadows of subconscious jails. See? The nameless pedophile unveils the Jekyll within his hide. He'll pause to look a while with a smile that seems self-justified. Look again. Eyes slit hard as the born-again Christian security guard sees a runaway daughter that resisted his charms in the poisonous vines of much older arms. Look again. The young mother shudders, sweet and sour, in the shadow of a sugar daddy overpower. And look again. The uncle lets slip his wolf mask in dread of the babysitter's stains that remain on her bed. Is there no end to such unspoken sorrows that drop from thin air at the feet of tomorrow? If age is wasted on age, as they say, and youth is wasted on youth, then love must be borrowed from time today. And unconventional love comes to rest in its own uncontestable truth. So we may lunch, if you will, on their image, at the banquet of sorrows unseen. Yet they intertwine history and hope, satin on crepe, where the new world is still being dreamed, and nothing is quite what it seems.
One thing I've really noticed in music is, like, especially in rock and, oh, not so much in rap, but a gravitation towards all things of a higher consciousness. It seems like everyone has collectively reached the conclusion is that we're sick of coming to the realization that it seems like this is all there is, but we know there isn't. We know there's a lot more to life than this, and we want that.
Well, more precisely, the social tendency is to try to persuade us that. Whereas we know opposite, then we know the opposite is actually more vividly real for us. Yeah, it's always a problem. But it's always going to happen in any society everywhere, because you can't govern the evolution of people. And when they have their breakthroughs, they have revelations. And I call that book Revelations 2012, because I think this year is going to be very alive and lots of vibration. And I think the potential for revelations is very, very high this year.
You're right.
I think a lot of people will have or have already had revelations about one thing or another. It's going to feel like a year of revelations. So that's why I wanted to dedicate a book of poetry to it.
Beautiful.
There is also a hardcover version of that book, which was put out by a really high craftsmanship publisher in England, but they're all sold out. They've become only a collector already.
Wow. Well, that's a good thing.
Yeah, there were 73 of them, and they were £73 English each.
Mm.
And they sold incredibly quickly.
I believe that.
73, because I was 73 years old at that time.
Well, how old are you now, David?
74.
Ah, nice. You're doing good.
Thank you, David.
You're even more spry than my mom.
I think one of the biggest fears, I was going to say before, I can say this one, is of growing old. Of growing old disgracefully.
You aren't doing that.
I don't know. I do my best. But yeah, there is this fear around that, because there's so many graphic images of old equal bad, young equal good, that... Yeah, well, but I suppose the function is that it pushes you back in on yourself as you grow older. You don't actually change at all, you know, in reality, but the pressure sort of like puts you in context with, try to force you into behaving in certain patterns. It's for us to break that one, because we don't want to be burdened with that. When you're my age, you don't want to be like people to be putting you over in the corner and offering you a rug.
No, you do not. You would rather be shot. Well, you know, or at least I would be, I'll put it that way.
I don't know, if it does happen that you're in that situation for some reason, some weird sickness hits you, and if somebody shows up with an offer of a chair and a nice warm rug when you're freezing cold, you go, oh yes, please, thank you very much, now I can listen, or now I can be here, now I can relax. So I think in that sense, it's okay too, but we always think of the worst possible scenario for growing old. There's an awful lot of people around who are, you know, are happy and well and balanced.
That's true. My grandfather was one of them. He was happy as a lark till the day he passed. And, you know, and that was when he was like, what, 94?
There you go.
So, I think really people aren't so much afraid of death as they used to be.
I don't think they are, but I think they're afraid of dying, or afraid of getting old.
Yeah, they're afraid of that, they're afraid of the discomfort. They're just, humans are crave equilibrium, and they don't want to be uncomfortable. That's all there is to it.
I don't know, I always think it's far better if people are made uncomfortable, and to feel uncomfortable. That's that time, you know, you're changing.
It's a reference point. It reminds you, remember when things were good? Remember when you didn't think anything of it?
That's right.
Now you will think better of that.
Yeah, one way or the other, we'll make up our own minds, won't we?
Definitely.
from the point of view of where we're at, in the context of that time.
You're listening to an interview with Daevid Allen of GONG, conducted by Dr. Sleeplesz, May 9th, 2012. celebration of his brand new album, Sound Bites for the Revelation, which is now available on Flame Dog Records and being debuted for its first airing in America on the Interstellar Nihilism show on Radio Valencia.
She made a mess of me.
All women are bad. All
gosh, there's so many things. Here's what I want to know. Okay, what is the origin of the track All Women Are Bad? Because it sounds like, okay, I should just probably read the liner notes because you have it listed here, I bet. Because it sounds like the music, where did the music from, okay, All Women Are Bad, but is that a sample or is that, it sounds like it's an entire piece. Or?
Well, no, I looped it up to make an entire piece of it.
Okay.
I took a loop of it and then I created from that. It's pretty much the same, but you can, you know, what you also sing with it and the way you work with it melodically on top makes it sound like it's different.
Yeah, and you're rapping over top of it. This is the one track on the album that I wasn't sure whether it was a collaboration or it sounds like nothing else. It has a hip hop feel. Let me just put it that way.
Sure. Well, you know, I'm surrounded by hip hop where I am. My son's into hip hop and I see a lot of hip hop going on around there, but trip hop, all the different types, all the different varieties. But I've had two sons who've been into it as well. Anyway, I really like female rapping. I like female rappers best.
And you also aren't going to get a lot of misogynistic rap out of female rappers. That's the thing I hate about rap the most, to be honest. But,
yeah, well, I might be being a bit anti-masculine this way, but I mean, they do go a bit over the top as well. The boys out there.
You be anti-masculine wearing blue dress and singing.
The view from where she sits is subterranean. It's below the belt, the pelt, beyond the pale. She is that svelte and velvet wolverine. She makes your pussy melt. This signal language, her vocab, this fingertip braille. Sorry if this stabs, she says. But I can never know where I may go, where there may be no rehab. Male or female, you are my experiment. I am your lab. My lap dance labulae, my labia lathers to a froth. For certain tongues that speak my language of the freak, where I shall peek and bite my screams back to a sob. This job is like no other job. There are no normal moments to endure. No daily brain jobs, shock jocks, kooks or geeks, but simply punk freaks from my books. So to my own aesthetic ethic, I stay pure. But much as I may lose my choice, in my mind I will choose to know and not to avoid experiential fate. I'll take these blows to my hopes, right on my own ego's nose, and bloodied as I might burn, I praise my chance to voice all that I learn. To voice, in song, our different languages of thought, until at last my everything dissolves to naught. For I am Madam Zero. Holy hall, encircled by accumulated knowledge, on the brink of all that is known. This knowing circle spins into a cycle, then a spiral, then a tranquil pond, across which we spin the stone of understanding. Watch it skim. Till finally, it leaps its last heartbeat, and love of life sinks in.
Thank the good Lord for masturbation, a pleasure that takes but one. To bring perfect communication 'twixt trigger, the fingers, and fun. No other mysterious body and soul whose pleasures are fathomed by a remote control. No need to worry if it's great or be sorry. Reject, be rejected, detect, be detected as faking or hurting when she should be groaning with ecstasy next to me. I should be virtuoso highly tuning her folk with the song at the tip of my tongue. Some onerous dunce who had tried wanking once with some sandpaper soap and a strangulous grope must have throttled his bonnet and spat spite upon it, invoking such religious shame in the act that this deep self-belligerence blighted the fact that to pleasure oneself is a personal wealth, a bodily elation. It relieves a constipation with flights neath the lids of the imagination. Thus I sing my praises with a tulip of wine. May long we refine the fine art of masturbation.
You're listening to an interview with Daevid Allen of GONG, conducted by Dr. Sleepless, May 9th, 2012, in celebration of his brand new album, Sound Bites for the Revelation, which is now available and being debuted for its first airing in America on the Interstellar Nihilism show on Radio Valencia.
The fires that we light will always burn us. Marysville, Iraq, Afghanistan. The waters that we poison, they will poison us. The Murray Darling, Mississippi, Cobalt Blue Danube turned black and tan. The air that we pollute will suffocate us. Chernobyl and Chicago, Shanghai, Azerbaijan. This has come to pass now to amaze us, this inevitable return. The screens that now we gaze at, they will blind us. If we hide from our controllers, they will find us, break controllers' rules, and they will cage us. All these problems should engage us, could enrage us, but they just don't faze us. They just don't faze us. They just don't faze us. All these problems will still face us when we return. And we will return. The children we have stolen will amaze us. They will show us why we go to blazes. They'll hand us back our 3D plastic Jesus. Maybe they'll bring a black Muhammad to replace us. Only we can understand how we create this when we return. And we will 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 return. And we will. And we will return, we will return, and we will return, we will return, and we will return, we will return, and we will return, and we will return, and we will
So on Sound Bites for the Revelation, you've got an amazing dichotomy of subject matter, ranging from, I especially love the dichotomy in relation to sexuality.
Okay.
Because, I mean, you have, especially, the last song, When You Kiss Me Like That, it alternates between various responses to a woman's kiss.
Yeah.
And the responses are highly dramatic.
Yeah.
I take it this is reflective of your own response to women, or?
It was one particular kiss. I mean, I guess we all have a moment, the perfect kiss, you know. Somebody comes to kiss us and we just go into this other dimension. And it's such a huge, massive transfer of energy just from this kiss, and it's so powerful and so perfect in every way that it matches you, and tastes and smells and everything else, and there's just this complete letting go, open vibe with it. That is something you remember for the rest of your life. I do it anyway. I do.
You're right about that.
Not so necessarily. You need to write a poem about that experience.
Although it does depend greatly upon the kisser and the kissy.
Well, of course, the whole package, really.
Yes.
You can't exclude anything. There's nothing mechanical about that kind of kiss.
Yeah.
It's got to have a sort of mixture of poignancy that you're just about to lose this kiss and never be able to taste it again. And at the same time, you know, there's the power that you carry in yourself in relation to the other person, how you handle that. There's a lot of things to consider.
It's so deep. And I guess that's why I think the entire planet is really trying to come to grips with how we can manifest the change in paradigm from fear to love.
Absolutely.
When you kiss me like that, I want to give up everything and become a monkey trainer. When you kiss me like that, I want to let go of giving up and become your slave. When you kiss me like that, I want to give up being your slave and dominate you ruthlessly. When you kiss me like that, I want to let go of power and embrace monogamy for improbable eons. When you kiss me like that, I want to reject you immediately and join the French Foreign Legion. When you kiss me like that, I want to make you my trophy wife and parade you spotlit in black tights on Fifth Avenue like the Champs-Élysées in Red Square, and then I want to lick your Arc de Triomphe on the 9 o'clock news. When you kiss me like that, I want to settle down with you in warm subtropical riverbed mud and ooze wickedly, nakedly. When you kiss me like that, my hair flies off to join a spiraling choir of spirulina gulls, but spins out to skydive back down into your egg cup. When you kiss me like that, my body memory plays back all our orgasms simultaneously. When you kiss me like that, I want to oil you with my slippery seed and massage it into your soul. And when you kiss me like that, I want to fill you brimming with my heart cock and weave unbelievable seabed spirals and stir your soft pot in starfish, mindless dervish. When you kiss me like that, I want to fuck you into little cries. Fuck you till our tears mingle. Fuck you into mutual oblivion, that the invisible becomes audible, the untouchable feels plausible, the unknowable becomes our body wisdom, revealing our love in see through body language on Sky TV.
I'll tell you that I'm really enjoying this album a lot. I think everyone is going to enjoy the hell out of it. And I'm looking forward. Really, are we going to be the first people to play this album in the States? That, you know?
Yeah, it's fresh off the printing press. It just happened. So.
Well, this is a real privilege for Radio Valencia and Interstellar Nihilism, which I obviously was accosted by Walter as I'm passing by for fantastically cosmic reasons. So, it's frankly scintillating, my friend.
Serendipity rules, dear boy.
So, you may be back here in September or August.
It's possible. I'll know that in the next couple of weeks.
Let me just ask you one more question. The gig that you just played, That was GONG Global.
Yep.
And that you're working with Josh, who's here in San Francisco.
Josh Pollock.
Josh who?
Josh Pollock.
Josh Pollock. And who else is in the band?
Ian East from England, the sax player with GONG now, the new young sax player with GONG. And then there's Fabio Golfetti, who is the guitar player who's coming on tour with GONG this year, and he lives in Brazil, although he's Italian. Then you have the Brazilian bassist and the Brazilian drummer, and the drummer is Fred.
Wow.
And Gabriel is the bassist. And that's that. This is the basic core of what was the Brazilian GONG, or otherwise known as GONG Global Family. But we're just calling it GONG Global now because it's a really nice, it's a specific, different attitude towards GONG, and it has a really interesting edge to it. It's quite rocky and it's quite political.
Wow!
And it's a fun band, and it's more easily accessible than classic GONG, where Steve and Mike and they're all very busy and doing stuff.
Right.
So I need to have another way to do something else. Meanwhile, while they're working on their thing.
Brilliant.
So I think GONG Global is a really nice thing to do.
Oh, certainly.
But in England this year, we're not doing GONG Global, we're doing GONG, was it GONG 2012, 99% hash.
Whoa.
So, yeah, GONG 2012, 99% hash.
As in hash mark or just hashish?
Hash mark.
Okay. We have to be specific for all of us pot smokers in the island.
Well, I live on the Pacific. How can I be more Pacific than to live on the Pacific?
To be Pacific, you are precise.
Specifically. Specifically imprecise.
Well, on that note, I think we'll end the tape recording portion of the afternoon.
Good afternoon, my friends. And good evening and good night.
So there he is, a fantastic interview with Daevid Allen, talking about things he'd just done, things he'd done long ago, and maybe even a bit about his new CD, Soundbites for the Revelation. The tracks from which we heard throughout the interview were entitled as follows: Market Forces, The Pope, Daughters of America, Slam Glam, Love Poem was track number 5, Jilly Song, The Answer is No, History and Hope, The Answer equals No, History and Hope, Whip is track number 9, All Women Are Bad, Madam Zero, Masturbation, Law of Return, and finally, Kiss Me Like That. This great CD is available, as we said, from flamedogrecords.com. Fantastic label run by David's son, Orlando. It has lots of interesting music on it. We can recommend it all. Please go check it out and order this fantastic CD of poetry for the new millennium from Daevid Allen of GONG. And now, cats, a little Muslim gals.
I'm sensing that people right now, and it's been going on for well over a year, are very, very edgy. I don't know why. You know, there have been some episodes that have occurred. We've had, you know, tsunamis and things, and I thought that they were like earth releasers, you know, almost like a pressure cooker that lets off steam, and maybe people would be okay again. It's something else, and I can't put my finger on it, but do you feel this?
I feel exactly the same thing. I began to feel that, you know, I really started to feel that. I was on a lecture tour of California in 05 and again in 06. And in 07, Ben and I went back there, and even he mentioned it at the time. Something is happening. I wish I could say that it's all good, all right? And we feel we, because of various, well, if you want to talk later about communication we've had in the multiverse with various species, if you will, crazy as it sounds, something is going on. I felt at the time, 06, 07, that people, certain people were being brought together to help deal with this, brought together by whom, I don't know, but people would come up to me and say this very thing before I'd even said anything about it. There was a feeling, and there is a feeling, that, as you say, people are edgy, and something is in the wind, and it's kind of approaching rather quickly. And